this will work.
Like, I assume.
All right, why don't we go ahead and get started? We talked a little bit yesterday about oil. And I was going to try to show you a version of a presentation I did that looked at some of the oil issues. And,
Just encourage it.
Yeah, we're worried about the incentive effects as opposed to ex post efficiency, right? So, all right, so the idea was, I was interested in the question of trying to understand what happened in the oil market. And I sort of said, well, let's just think about the world in terms of supply and demand. And, you know, as an economist, I mean, obviously supply and demand is probably one of our most fundamental tools. And of course, we have the age-old identification problem in economics, that is, you know, how do you know what's supply and what's demand? And fundamentally, the data we get as economists, you can think of, if we're thinking about a single marketplace, as data on P&Q. And think about there having, say, just start with two periods of time. In period one, I see P1, Q1, and in period two, I see a data point, P2, Q2. What can I say based on the data? What can I say about what happened with supply and demand based on those changes that we see?
Josh, you're shaking your head. What's the answer?
It's got to be to equilibrium, both, or it could be that you're...
You can't say anything.
The supply moved, so it's not identified.
You can't say anything.
Well,
what can you say?
You can limit the choices of what this could tell me.
Okay, but you're limited. You can't tell me everything. But what can you tell me? What can you tell me about what happened to demand? What can you tell me about what happened to supply? What can you tell me? So let me first define something. So let's say if demand goes from here to here, I'll call that shift delta D. I'll define that to be the change in demand. It's simply, at a given price, how much more people want to buy. And when supply shifts, I'll call that delta S. It's how much more suppliers want to sell in a given quantity. So given this market evidence that I see here, what can I tell you about supply and demand? In particular, what can I tell you about delta Q and delta D and delta S? Let's call this distance in percentage terms delta Q. Let's call this distance delta Q. Measure everything in log changes to make life easy. What can I tell you? Just looking at the picture, the way it looks.
Quantity
did go up. So what can you tell me about delta D and delta S?
They can't both be negative.
They can't both be negative. Say more than that. Try to do this quickly. What can we infer from the fact that delta P went up, that delta P is positive?
That's demand shift effort.
Delta D bigger than delta S, right? But do you agree with that? That is, demand must have shifted further to the right than did supply. Because if they both shifted by the same amount, price wouldn't have changed. And if demand had shifted less than supply, price would have gone down. So immediately I know delta D is bigger than delta S. What else do I know? Draw the picture. What do I know? How about delta D bigger than delta Q? For sure. I know demand increased at least as much as quantity did because price went up, which choked off some of the demand increase. So in fact, I know that delta D is bigger than delta Q. Is bigger than delta S. You Because supply must have done that. No matter what slope I put on the supply curve, it has to have shifted to the right less than delta Q. And no matter what slope I put on a demand curve, it must have shifted to the right more than delta Q. So far then from being able to say nothing, I in fact not only know that delta D is bigger than delta S, but I actually know they straddle delta Q. The delta Q is between the two of them. So when delta P is positive, that implies delta D bigger than delta Q, bigger than delta S. Delta P is negative, we know delta D is less than delta Q, less than delta S. That's what we know. But I always think that that's a lot. That's actually not trivial. You a little surprised? That?
No.
No. Okay, all right. I thought you said we couldn't say anything.
No, I thought in terms of like identifying the equilibrium, that's I think.
No, you don't need to identify. We see the equilibrium, right? That's the key. We see the equilibrium that's out there. Okay? So you actually can put put bounds on what happens to delta demand and supply over this period of time. There's a limited set of explanations that can explain it. Now, if
so market systems are partially identified even without instruments and
exactly. That is the behavior of supply and demand is partially identified by the slope restrictions. That the restrictions that demand slopes down and supply slopes up gives us some identification in and of itself.
Are we assuming linear demand and supply curves? No.
No. I mean, I know this point. I know that this point here is down and to the right of that one. So I know that delta D is bigger than delta Q, because that's delta Q. I don't care what slope, as long as it's downward sloping, that's all I need.
And the equilibrium, that's crucial.
And we're in equilibrium. Well, not even clear that we're in equilibrium. The demanders are in equilibrium. In order to identify the demand curve, all I need is that the demand curves are, I'm on the demand curve. We could even be off the supply curve and we could still get delta D bigger than delta Q. As long as I'm on the demand curve, I don't even have to have a model of supply. I can do this whole analysis without even ever bringing supply into the picture. All I need to know is that I'm on the demand curve in the two periods. I was on the demand curve here and I'm on the demand curve here because the change in quantity I observe, remember, from the point of view of demand, see, this is one of the things people often forget. From the point of view of demand, delta Q is equal to delta D plus the elasticity of demand, delta P. As long as I'm on the demand curve, this equation has to hold.
Not the delta S versus delta D, right?
Exactly. So I can make any statement about D versus Q by saying I'm on the demand curve. Any statement of Q versus S by saying I'm on the supply curve. And I can do my analysis only of one side of the market. People always think, well, don't I need both sides? The answer is not really. I mean, this formula holds even with one side of the market. Don't model the other side of the market. Just say I'm on the demand curve. Well, then every change in quantity consumed has to consist of two components. A movement along the demand curve, which is here, and a shift in the demand curve here. Every equilibrium point you see, I get this point, I get this point, I get this point, I get that point, I get this point, I get this point. Every one of those points has to be composed of some movement in the demand curve and some movement along the demand curve. That's just the algebra. Okay.
Kevin, when you say on the demand curve, what's the other choice? That there's some kind of quantity restrictions, so you're not on it, or I mean, I don't know. What
yeah, you're you could have like some rationing. You could have some rationing story. So it could be that the people would want, you know, like say I had a price control, then I might get, even if demand went up, I might get prices go down and quantities go down, which would say unambiguously demand must have gone down. But you know, if I had a price control, Now, if I can measure the length of the line and I can measure all that other crap, then I could probably measure what really happened to demand. But it has to be that whatever I'm measuring here is decentralizing whatever decision making I see over on that side. So what would happen in the world would be that. Similarly, we can write delta Q equals delta D, delta S plus epsilon S delta P. Right? Same thing. That's the supply side of the market. Now, if you want to talk about equilibrium, you just equate these two things together, and you get delta D plus epsilon D delta S equals delta S plus epsilon S delta P, because change in quantity for the matters has to be the same as the change in quantity for supply. Now, this imposes equilibrium. This is using equilibrium here. This is just using one side of the market at a time.
Equilibrium is crucial. I mean, it's true. Each inequality with respect to Q depends only on being one of the curves. But to order the two D's and the S's, then you have to have them both.
Exactly. But, the stricter, but it's actually interesting because the stricter inequality, the more binding inequality is always with respect to Q. It's not with respect to S. So actually, if you say what empirical content can I predict about D, actually, the Q data actually give me the tighter restriction than saying it's bigger than delta S, because it's not only bigger than delta S, it's actually bigger than delta Q. So that actually gives me the most bite in terms of prediction.
Do you allow for elasticity to change?
Well, elasticity to change, remember when we did Fisher and Posh price indices? Allowing the elasticity to change is really just like choosing Fisher, Posh, the spares, because think of it this way. Now I'm going to draw both curves and both dots. I go from this point to that point. So this is P0, this is P1, Q0, Q1. Now, I can either define this to be delta D, and then this movement here to be epsilon D delta P, or I can define this movement here to be epsilon d delta p, put a twiddle there, and this delta d twiddle. It's exactly like the Lesperre's and Posh kind of story. It's either you measure the demand shift at the initial price and then measure the movement along the new demand curve, or measure the movement along the old demand curve and then measure the shift at the new price. Just like when we had our price and quantity indices, and one was always like period one basis, and one was always period two basis. Or you can pick some intermediate demand curve, measure part of the shift along this one, part of the shift along that one, and movement along the intermediate demand. That'd be like the Fisher index. So the same logic, in fact, that sort of idea that you always have to have different bases for the two, if you're going to choose one of the years or the other, this is general to all decompositions. All decompositions have that problem.
That ordering would apply even if the...
That orderings apply either way. The orderings are invariant to that. The exact quantitative decomposition depends upon these things here. But the orderings will always be the same no matter which decomposition I use. Okay. Because the ordering just depends on that this curve slopes down and that curve slopes down. Now, if one of these bent backwards and one sloped down, then the orderings could disagree. Okay. Any questions that people have? Now, once we impose equilibrium, okay, we get the very, this is delta P. That's delta, yeah. So this implies delta D minus delta S equals epsilon S minus epsilon T delta P. So this implies delta P equals delta D minus delta S divided by epsilon S minus epsilon T. So this is a very nice formula to always keep in mind. It tells me the change in price depends on how much demand shifts relative to supply. and divided by, this is really sum because that's a negative number, so this is really like adding together the two elasticities. Okay? So the price response to a shift in demand relative to supply depends on the reciprocal of the sum of the two elasticities. Okay? You understand how that works. All right, that's actually a nice formula to keep in mind. Now, in the case of oil, these two numbers turn out to be pretty small, particularly in the short run. This number is a number like 0.1. This is a number like minus 0.1. What means is this denominator is about less than 0.2, which means that shifts in demand and supply get multiplied up pretty highly. Doesn't take a big shift in supply and demand to move prices quite a bit. So if this number is 0.2, then a 1% shift in demand relative to supply will lead to a 5% change in price. Okay, so you're going to get a pretty big responsiveness when both supply and demand are relatively inelastic. If either of them is highly elastic, remember either being highly elastic, then price isn't going to change much. Because they're so elastic that, you know, one of the markets shifts out, it doesn't really have a big impact. Now, the quantity effects, you get the quantity effects, we just plug that back in, we get delta Q equals delta D plus epsilon D delta D minus delta S divided by epsilon S minus epsilon D, which is equal to epsilon S minus epsilon D delta D plus epsilon D delta D minus epsilon D delta S divided by epsilon S minus epsilon D. And this one kills this one. Equals epsilon S delta D divided by epsilon S minus epsilon D minus epsilon S delta S, epsilon D delta S over epsilon S minus epsilon D. What do you notice about delta Q? What is delta Q? Which is makes it obvious why that little hole. How do you want to think about delta Q?
Weighted average.
It's a weighted average of the shifts in supply and demand. Because remember, the demand elasticity is negative. So this is really, these weights, epsilon S over this and minus epsilon D over this, they sum to one. So the shift in quantity you observe is a weighted average of the shifts in supply and demand. Where the weights are, the other elasticity. So the supply shift gets weighted by the demand elasticity and the demand shift gets weighted by the supply elasticity. So the way I always like to think about the world is the shift in price tells me about the difference in the two shifts. The shifts in quantity tell me about the average of the two shifts. That's what you're seeing when you see a market. When you see the price and quantity change, the quantity change is telling you on average what happened to supply and demand, and the price shift is telling me kind of the difference between what happened to supply and demand. Now it's not exactly, you know, you need to, if you know the elasticities, then life is good, right? If you had estimates of the elasticities, then we can use these two formulas and we can go delta D equals delta Q minus epsilon D delta P, and delta S equals delta Q minus epsilon S delta P. So when you know both elasticities, you can do a lot more. Not only can you tell me inequalities, you can actually measure the shifts in supply and demand. So I took the oil data and I set out to try to do this, and this is the right file. Something Gary and I did, so this is
was in October 08, so this was last year. Most of the stuff I just did. So we took real prices. This is the real price data through time up through 2007. And you'll notice that, you know, there's a couple of big things. There's the first oil price spike that happened in 1975. There's the Iran-Iraq war spike that happened in the early 1980s, after which prices came way back down. I wish I had the graph, because this line kind of goes back pretty flat way back before that. I have an earlier graph that has that.
What's interesting there, Kevin, is that, you know, people always emphasize the increase in oil prices in the 70s when OPEC was really formed. But you look at the Iran-Iraq war in the early 80s, that had a really big impact.
Yeah, that was huge relative to the increase. Well, I mean, this was...
Well, partly nominal, but still it was a big real increase.
Yeah, exactly. This is real prices here, so you really have, like, you know, here you kind of double prices, and then you kind of more than double prices from a higher base. And prices in 08 get higher than this peak. Now they're back well below that peak because of where they were in 07. This is what happened to quantity over time. And you can see the impact that happened when, you know, that you can see that supply shock, right? You can definitely see that that spike upward was associated with supply shock. So I use these equations here armed with some estimates of elasticities that we got from the literature. There's a little complication because I wanted to allow for the difference between short run and long run. I don't have time to show you how I did that, so think of it as doing this, but it's a little more complicated because I actually tried to allow for short run versus long run on both the demand side and the supply side. But the logic's the same. This is what we got for demand for crude oil over this period of time. This is relative to trend. So you see there was a huge demand shock that happened. And this big run up in the 2000s really was demand related. So when people talk about, you know, there must have been some demand shock, definitely appears. But the demand shock starts back here in about early, you know, in the late 90s.
That was booming world increase in GDP, China,
yeah.
Other countries leading that.
Now the interesting thing that happened is you clearly see the first two supply shocks. Right. This is the 75 supply shock. This is this Iran-Iraq war supply shock. So we had two big negative supply shocks. These are big numbers. I mean, the scales here are huge. So we got a huge reduction in supply. Then supply gradually eased for a long time. And the reason prices went up so much in the recent period is that there actually was, particularly right at the end. See, right at the end there, and if you extend this into 08, it gets even more severe. It was a very, at the, you know, graphs are always kind of misleading. If you cut this thing off at 2005, there hasn't been much downturn. There was a big downturn in the last few years in supply that happened at the same time demand was going out, which is what really pushed the prices up.
We had various supply disruptions, like in Nigeria,
yes.
Iraq,
exactly. Elsewhere. Now, and the other issue here is an issue of what do you want to call supply here? Because remember, oil is a durable resource, so future demand shocks translate into contemporaneous supply shocks because people will supply less than the market today if they think demand and prices are going to be higher in the future. I did a little simulation, which I always think is a neat simulation to do. This is what would have happened. This is the actual prices, the blue line, and the red line is what would happen if supply had been stable and the only thing had shifted had been demand. And you can pretty much see that really the only thing that demand really did was had some effect driving up prices in the early 70s and a very large effect driving up the prices in the recent period. I then said, well, what was caused by supply? That is, what would happen if demand had stayed fixed over time and supply had done all the work? Clearly, supply explains the first two oil shocks very, very well. They were basically supply shocks. Demand didn't do much at all in that period. And then you can see what I'm talking about here, that supply contributed at the very end. So the big run-up in oil prices in the late, you know, in the in the late 2000s here has been really driven, and mid to late 2000s has been really driven by primarily a demand shock and reinforced by a supply shock that occurred during that period as well. Well, demand is more important than supply in that period. Does that make sense to people? So that's
the demand shock also shows up is that other commodity prices.
Absolutely.
I don't think that happened. Pretty sure it didn't happen actually in the 70s, and early 80s, right?
Not as much. Although, you know, there was a big, like aluminum prices had a huge, metal
like
prices had a big run down.
Like soybeans, all these.
No, that's
were up a lot.
That's different. Yeah, that is different. Not as big a deal on commodities. Although some of the metals had similar patterns. Any questions that people have? No doubt. You can see the demand shock in tons of other areas. You know, you see it in aluminum, you can see it in all the metals, you can see it in almost all the commodities. Any questions that people have? So this is kind of just an idea of what you can do with kind of some pretty simple analysis.
Well, why would you want to know if the supplier products, where do you go next, I guess?
Well, I think first of all, if you want to forecast what's going to happen in the future, you might be interested in knowing, you know, to what extent is it demand versus supply, because they might have very different persistence.
So you factors. Have to have, you have some different theories about what are the kinds of things that are likely to drive each one of them, basically.
It also says if I'm going to build a model and correct.
So you figure those disruptions probably they're going to likely to end. Well, the growth of demand from the world, China, and so on, that presumably
more persistent.
Will persist.
Or if you're going to start building a model, and you want to know what data I'm going to go try to collect. Am I going to try to collect data on what's going on in oil fields around the world in terms of fires and all those things? Or do I want to look at what's going on with global GDP, industrial changes? I mean, different variables. The fundamental notion of economics is that different variables inter-supply than inter-demand. If the same variables entered supply and demand,
not a very interesting distinction.
It's not as interesting as when we say, okay, what's demand about? It's about growth in China, it's about growth in India, it's about concerns about future global warming and demand for oil in the future. It's about all those kinds of things. What's supply about? It's about OPEC, it's about supply reductions due to
terrorism
or discoveries of new resources or constraints on, you know.
I mean, that's a fundamental point for all supply and demand analysis, that the forces affecting supply are to a large extent different from the forces affecting demand. If they were the same, the framework would be much less useful.
Yeah, I agree. All right, that's.
So how do you deal with uncertainty in this? Like, is there any way in which this is sensitive in such a way that it changes the underlying takeaways?
It could. Uncertainty, since we're dealing with like realized prices and quantities, doesn't directly change your interpretation of where demand is. But when you go to model why demand is where it is, that's where the uncertainty would come in. So for example,
too.
And supply, no, I mean supply and demand.
Okay.
So I mean, in fact, the example I was going to give is from the supply side. So, for example, people's expectations about what the future demand for oil is going to be, and few people's expectation about what the supply of alternative sources to energy might be, could actually be an important driver of current supply in this world. Now, let's say people thought in the future there were going to be tighter environmental restrictions. How do you think that would affect the future demand for oil or the future and therefore the current supply of oil? So people, you know, over this period, global warming grew as a concern. So as global warming grows as a concern, you think that should have an effect of raising oil prices or lowering oil prices? How would you think about it? Yeah.
It's all raise our prices currently because suppliers anticipate the decline in demand in the future because of heavier taxation. So they want to sell maybe more oil now while the prices are still not affected by the taxation.
So what would it do to prices today then?
It will increase the price today.
How would it increase the prices today under your story? Oh, your story
sorry,
is
sorry, oh, decrease,
decrease the prices.
So supply will increase.
Okay. That would seem like an unlikely explanation, according to that theory at least, for why prices for oil might have gone up. Yeah?
Well, there's also a countervailing effect. If you have to buy an oil rig that's going to last 100 years and you think in 20 a carbon tax will be irrelevant, then you're less likely to invest now because it'll have 100% depreciation in 20 years.
Okay, so you're saying
it depends on the durability of assets.
So what you're saying is rather than the supply of oil in the future and the supply of oil today being substitutes, which is the classic exhaustible resource explanation, you're using a more standard model that we would use for other commodities that says supply of a commodity over time is actually a complement because of capital investment. You want, you know, it's like building capacity produces output in more than one period. So one way to think about the standard capacity model is that supply is complementary over time. The more demand there's going to be tomorrow or the more demand there was yesterday, the bigger supply would be today. Okay. Any other effects? One of the things that I would think about would be to think about, you know, remember the story we talked about competition? I mean, competition is like, it's like, you know, it's like the old story about the two guys in the forest and a bear comes and one guy starts running and the guy goes, why are you running? You can't outrun a bear. And he goes, I don't have to outrun a bear. I just have to outrun you, right? That's a very important, that's like one of the most important stories in economics, right? So, because it's the essence of what we talked about the other day in terms of profits, right? The profits you make are not how fast you run, but how much faster you run than the other guy, right? So let's say we have, what are some of the major alternatives to oil?
Natural gas.
Natural gas. Coal.
Hydropower.
Hydro. What about oil supplies like tar sands or shale oil? Would they be hurt more or less than liquid crude under the ground by environmental restrictions? More. Those, you know, coal, much more polluting than oil is. Tar sands takes an enormous amount of energy just to get the stuff out of the ground. Shale is tremendously environmentally unfriendly. So one story you can tell, and I don't know if it's right, but certainly worth investigating, is whether in fact that kind of policy against emissions actually, while it hurts oil, hurts its substitutes even more, making oil actually more attractive relative to the alternative. So you got to think that way. You got to think about markets, right? That's the key. You got to think about, you know, it's not, everything doesn't always go the way you think. It's not like, well, it's bad for oil directly, so it must be bad for oil. Well, if it's worse for the alternatives, it's actually good for oil. So you got to be careful about that. I don't know if that's right in this case, but I point it out because it's something worth thinking about, and it's a general concept that I think we often get wrong. We tend to focus on, it's like the cost increase. Well, that should be bad, right? Well, no, not if your competitors are more dependent on that input than you are. Cost increase is good. Okay, so you got to be careful when thinking about those kinds of things.
In fact, you know, some policies are really the result of some firms trying to get regulations on their competitors that they think will hurt their competitors more than themselves. They may end up with more profits, even though they're facing greater regulation.
Yeah, absolutely. So like the biggest opponents to expanded places to dump garbage are places, guys who already own places to dump garbage, right? I mean, those are the guys. Even though they might be one of the major buyers of those places, they know their current assets are worth more if they can restrict access, even their own access to new facilities. Yeah. Question?
I was just wondering, where are the elasticities that you're using to decompose these demand and supply effects coming from?
Well, there's been various estimates that people have made off of kind of market shocks. So, for example, you can use those earlier OPEC-driven price changes to try to measure the demand elasticities, right? We know
so
that
ones,
those...
ones that are out of sample. Because, I mean, it just seems like, you know, how do you use the data that's in the graphs that you're showing us to both estimate the elasticities and estimate the...
Well, you could do, as long as you knew. You would have to know, in order to, if you wanted to estimate the elasticities, you'd have to know is that some of those moves were exogenous. You don't have to know they're all exogenous, right? So let's say I knew that supply shifted exogenously point A, point B, point C. I could estimate the demand elasticity off of that episodes. I could then use that demand elasticity for the whole period, even the periods in which demand shifts weren't, supply shifts weren't exogenous. So you can use data within the sample. You probably wouldn't want to just have an OLS regression within the sample, because the OLS regression is gonna confuse kind of the supply and demand shifts. So you'd have to have some IVs that would be moving during the sample. Often this is estimated off of other sources. So for example, what people will do is they'll say, okay, there was an OPEC shock, and then you look at the supply response of non-OPEC countries. So you can actually use a supply shock for some people to identify the supply elasticity of other people. You understand how that works, right? Because from your point of view, your supply curve hasn't shifted, so we can move you along your supply curve. Now, that is a little touch and go in a world in which there's kind of this durable stock, and then if you don't save for the future, I'm gonna save for the future. You've gotta be a little careful. It's better in most markets, actually, than it would be in this one.
And also, I mean, you know, sort of scaling it up, because Venezuela might not have the ability to just increase their oil production the way that Saudi Arabia could.
Oh, yeah, and that varies a lot across countries. You know, so for example, if I have a deep sea well, that's gonna be different than Saudi Arabia, who's got a bunch of capped wells sitting there who could obviously respond pretty quick. Yes, so I would agree with that. All right, let me move on, because we do have some other stuff we wanna cover, but I do think it's worthwhile thinking about these things. Now, one of the things that's been floating around in almost every discussion we had up till now is capital. And I'm going to talk a little bit about capital because it's actually turns out to be central to much of economic analysis. It's behind, you know, much of business cycle theory. It's certainly behind monster production theory. It's also behind our notions of short, long run demand, all implicitly depend, at least in some way, on some form of capital. So, what is capital? How would you define capital?
K.
Cash. K is capital. Well, how about if I write an equation for you? What does that equation say? What? This is capital today? Is what we had yesterday depreciated by whatever the depreciation rate is, plus whatever new investment we make today. The key idea behind capital is it's durable. And when you have a durable asset, there's a distinction between the stock and the flow. And the more durable the asset is, the more disconnected the stocks and flows can become. Okay? So, like for strawberries are durable. They last a week. So, stocks and flows are pretty intimately related, right? They can't get too far apart. You have frozen strawberries, but fresh strawberries, the stocks and flows are pretty closely related. They don't minute by minute, they don't have to add up. You can eat them at night even if they pick them during the day. Okay? So there's a kind of stock flow distinction for most assets, but the longer the lag, the lower the depreciation rate, the more important this durability becomes.
And there are many types of capital assets. There are production assets that go to firms, there are household capital assets like houses, cars, washing machines, clothes, and all that kind of stuff. And they all kind of obey an equation that looks something like that. So the amount of capital we have today is, you can rewrite this as kt minus 1 minus delta kt minus 1 plus it. The amount of capital we have today is what we had yesterday minus what depreciated plus whatever we add today. That's our capital stock equation. Any questions that people have? So like in the housing market, what would these be? What would K be? Market for housing.
Number of units.
Number of units what?
Number of houses.
That are out there, right?
Yeah.
The stock of housing we have. What would I be? New construction. Probably include renovation and other stuff too, but yeah, new additions to the housing. What would transactions of houses be? Nothing to do with this, right? That's the first thing to always remember. The transactions are about how many people want a different house today than they had yesterday. That doesn't tell you diddly about this, right? The transactions may be related for some other reasons to this, but they don't directly measure any of these things. People get that confused all the time. They sort of sit down and think about transactions. This is not about transactions. This is about additions to the stock and depreciation of the stock. This is the quantity side of the asset of the capital goods world. What about the price side of the capital goods world? How do you think about the price side? Well, just like there are stocks and flows, there are two prices. I'll call it PT, what I'll call the capital price. That's how much you pay to buy a new unit of the good. That's how much you pay to buy the good. PT, and I'm going to distinguish that from RT, which is the rental price, which is how much you pay to use the good for one period. That's the distinction between the capital price and the rental price. How are they related? The easiest way I always think of, because I'm not good at remembering formulas, the way I think about it is the rental rate. How do I rent the place? Think of a world where it's illegal to rent. You can only buy and sell. How would you define the rent? How would you do the equivalent of rent? What would you do to rent? You want to use it for a period.
You buy it at the beginning and sell at the end.
Right? That's our rental rate formula. The rental price of an asset is simply the price you pay to get it today minus the present value of what you can sell it for in the future. You write that out, 1 plus R PT minus PT plus 1 minus delta all over 1 plus R equals, I'll rewrite this as RPT plus delta PT plus 1 plus PT minus PT plus 1 all over 1 plus R. It's a very nice formula to remember, because if you want to calculate a rental price on an asset that you only have the purchase price for, that's the formula you gotta try to use. You want, now why is it important to know the rental price? Why is it important to know rental prices? Remember my problem from yesterday? Max, P, F of L and K minus RK minus WL. Well, I need to know it for here, right? If I want to predict what a profit-maximizing firm is going to do today in terms of producing output and using capital, I got to understand what the rental price is. So
So when you go to calculate the rental price on the asset, you need to think about these terms. All right. So what does this say the rental price on an asset is? Where does the rental price come from? What are the key ingredients?
Interest rate.
Interest rate. So often when people talk about the price of capital, this always confused me when I first learned capital. People talked about the price of capital, and they said, well, the price of capital is the interest rate. Okay? I thought to myself, wait a minute. Let's say I'm a shoemaker. The price of capital is the interest rate? Don't I care about what it costs to buy a shoemaking machine? Doesn't like the price of the machine matter? Why is it only the interest rate? The answer is it's not only the interest rate. It's the interest rate times the price of the shoemaking machine. That's the opportunity cost of the money you put in the shoemaking machine. So when you think about the cost of capital for the firm, you gotta think not just about the interest rate, you gotta think about what happened to the price of the underlying asset or capital goods, machines and the like. Getting cheaper or more expensive. So this is your opportunity cost. What's this?
Appreciation.
What? Appreciation. So in a simple sense, you can say rental costs are interest and depreciation on my asset. That would be true if prices weren't changing. What is this term? Capital gain or capital loss, right? This is the actual capital loss on the machine, okay? And because all these, you know, you would have got paid the interest in period two, the stuff you lose you don't have in period two, and the loss is incurred in period $2, that's why everything's divided by 1 plus R. This is all in the future period. Okay, so the 1 plus R is just kind of a basic notion. So if you wanted to cost out a capital asset, you might say, okay, this is 0.06, this is 0.1 if it lasts 10 years roughly. So let's think about something. I gave you a problem on the initial questions about computers, right? So let's do this for a computer. How big do you think each of these terms are? So this term is about 6% of the price. What's delta for computers?
One.
How long do they last?
2 to 3 years.
2 to 3 years? Do they really only last 2 to 3 years? Let me make it more concrete. Let's say I'm in the telephone business and I'm buying electronic switches. They're going to switch telephone calls. How long do you think those switches would last if I just let them, I use them? They don't break. They stick around for a long time. This number is actually not that big in terms of pure depreciation. I think this number is like 0.1. But what about this term? This term is big. This term is a big number. This term is, what do we say? Moore's law is right. If you take Moore's law, it's enormously big. Productivity, processing power doubles every 18 months. That overstates the real growth in productivity. But let's say this is 0.25 of the price, right? Because everything relative, just divide everything moved by the price, and then you get R plus delta PT plus 1 over PT. Plus PT minus PT plus 1 over PT, all that over 1 plus R times P. So I'm thinking of everything in these percentage terms. So this would say that the rental cost of a computer is about 41% of the purchase price, which sounds about right. It's worth about 2.5 years or something like that. The rental price is 41% of the purchase price. What would happen if computers stopped improving?
People would buy more.
Yeah. this number would go away, the rental cost would plummet. The rental cost of computers would fall from 41% of the purchase price to 16% of the purchase price, which is like 2.5. So you'd have like a 70% reduction in the price of computers. You think about these guys as demanding computers for use in production, the demand for computers would go way, way up. People would buy a ton of computers in response to a stop in progress.
So this captures the the common sense idea, kind of, that if you're expecting things to improve in the future, you hold off sort of buying the item.
Yeah, the point is, for these assets, the amount of holding off is very large. That is a big reason limiting the demand for computers. One of the major forces limiting the use of computer equipment is the fact that the computer equipment is going to be better in the future. And when that stops, there's going to be a huge growth in demand. Of course, that's going to be followed by a huge dearth in demand, because right now we're replacing our computers kind of economically every couple of years. We're going to go to replacing them every 10 years. So what's going to happen is we're going to have demand, and then it's going to go way down below where it otherwise would have been. Which, if you think about from a production standpoint, is an interesting issue. What is capacity in the computer industry going to look like? In a world in which the supply of computers was perfectly elastic, sales of computers would go like that. But obviously that can't happen if we have assets used to produce computers. That's going to get all smoothed out. Yeah?
But it's kind of weird to think about this in terms of computers, because like the price is really the price per unit of power, but computers come bundled. Like, so I can't buy, you know, the same computer that I bought 3 years ago for much cheaper today. I'm going to get a much more powerful computer for maybe the same price.
You can buy the same computer for cheaper, but I agree with you.
Well, for cheaper.
If you think about a price quality curve, it's not shifting down uniformly. I would agree with that. It's kind of extending to the right more than price per unit quality is falling more than absolute prices are. And so the effect of this depends upon the usage. That's why I gave the example of like electronic switches. For electronic switches, there's great substitution between quantity and quality. If I have an electronic switch that can switch 1,000 calls, and the next generation one can switch 10,000 calls, I only need 1/10 as many. So those guys, for people, for uses like that, there's not a great distinction here, because I can substitute more processing power for number of units. Very quality and quantity are kind of very good substitutes in that example. That's why I've used that example. That would be kind of the most extreme version. For me, with a laptop or a desktop PC, it's harder because, you know, I can't type any faster. So there are uses I can put. I can get better graphics. I can do all kinds of other stuff as computing power grows. But yeah, I agree with you. The effective price isn't falling as rapidly there. Okay. So.
So
I didn't use the Moore's Law number, though. The Moore's Law number is a much bigger number than that, right? The Moore's Law number says productivity doubles every 18 months, okay? Which is, you know, astronomical rate of improvement.
So you'd expect, like, servers and server racks and disk racks and
yeah, things like that. Server racks are another good example. You know, as I increase throughput on a server, I just have fewer servers. You know, the guy's got 1,000 servers now, he can have 200. Next time.
Cluster computing or whatever.
Cluster computing or whatever. Now, for you and me, quality and quantity are less good substitutes.
So when quality is improving rapidly over time, you would expect the sort of durability, physical durability of the good to go down. It isn't
absolutely
worth a while to put the resources in to make them more durable, and people are going to be replacing them pretty quickly.
Absolutely.
And you see that in a lot of different goods.
Yes, absolutely.
Not so much in housing, because that's improvements are much smaller.
Yes, exactly. No, you do see the fact that we're going to be less emphasis on durability. Any questions that people have? All right, so how do you build a model? The simple capital goods model, I'm going to do it real quick because we only have a little bit of time, but it's important to think about. How do we put this into a model? So these are just, everything I've done so far is accounting. So our goal, of course, is this, right? Right, that's our goal. So we want to get there. How do we get there? Okay? So let's think about the demand side of the model. So this is demand for, if K is housing, this is demand for places to live. If K is productive firm level assets, this is the demand for capital by firms. What goes on the two axes? Think about that problem over there. It's pretty obvious what are on the two axes. R and K. Right, because the demand side for capital uses the stock, and the price being paid to use the stock is the rental price. You have the flow price and the stock quantity. What about the supply side of capital? These are the guys who build houses, make cars, make machines. Well, what they make is I. And what do they care about? P. Because that's what they get when they produce. So an equilibrium in this market looks like this. RT, KT, PT, IT. So that's an equilibrium we have in the marketplace today. We have a rental price and a stock, and a capital price and an investment, and that's equilibrium. How do I put those two pieces together? Can I just lay those two on top of each other? Yeah.
Well, I mean, in equilibrium, if KT is not changing, that means you know that IT is equal to delta KT.
Okay. So you got a great idea, which is trick to thinking about this problem is you're going to think about what we might think of as a steady state. Okay. And let's think about my steady state. I'm going to write down four equations and see if you agree with me. I'm going to use a bar for the steady state values. I'm going to have K bar equals D of R bar. That is, whatever our steady state stock has to be, it has to be equal to how much the buyers. Yeah.
Can I pause you for a minute on this?
Sure.
First graph. One of the things that I think I always thought is kind of interesting about this is, you know, you have the stock on the quantity side and the flow price, the rental rate on the y-axis.
And here you have the
exactly. So I mean, what that's saying is, like, to get the use out of the capital, you put the whole stock in a use. So it's not like you take a piece of it off and use it to get R. You put the whole stock in a use.
Yeah, it's like houses. You right. You know, all the places where people live are all the new houses plus all the old houses.
Yeah.
And you drive all the old cars plus all the, but it is important to realize that.
Yeah, which is why capital is so sensitive to things like theft and, you know, depreciation, fires, risks, all that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
I mean, even before we get an equilibrium, you can already kind of see that coming out of this framework that it explains why capital likes to run from danger, because you got to put all of it on. You got to put all of it on the line to get your R out of it.
Exactly. So, like, take an example. What Jess is saying here is, let's assume that, you know, now the computers, theft of computers is such a big deal. Let's take a long-lived asset. Let's say R equals 0.06, delta equals 0.02. So, like housing or something like that. Or some long-lived capital asset. Then the rental price, roughly in steady state, is about 8% of the capital price. If there's a 1% chance that people are going to steal your capital, what does that do to your return? Well, it reduces your gross return from 8% to 7%. It reduces your net return from 6% to 5%. So that's net of depreciation. So it's a huge change. If you tell me there's a 5% chance that the government's going to steal your capital or the warlords are going to steal your capital, suddenly instead of costing 8%, it costs 13%. So it's not a 5% risk. Relative to what you're collecting, that 5% is a huge risk. Yes.
If you're trying to model something like it being stolen or destroyed, would you put that in the depreciation rate? Like if there's a 5%?
It's equivalent to depreciation from your point of view. Although it might not show up in the aggregate stock equation, right? You would get an asymmetry between this delta, because assuming the thieves are going to use it, it still contributes to the overall stock. So this delta stays the same.
Depends on whether they're burning it or taking it.
Yeah, but if they're going to use it, that delta is different from this.
That's the arson aggregate differently.
Arson, yeah, exactly. Arson and theft aggregate differently. It's a little bit like in the drug problem, where the government, you know, might want to steal the drugs from the drug lords and sell them. You know, because that'll lower the drug lord's return, but won't push up the price in the market. But anyway, so any other questions that people have? All right. So where do we go?
Well, you're going into those steady state equations.
Yeah, steady state we got here, K equals D of R, K bar. Number two, if I look at my price equation, I get R bar has to be equal to P bar times 1 minus delta over 1 plus R. Right, just factor the P out of my equation over there, and that tells me that the steady state rental price has to be proportional to the steady state capital price. Number three, I bar has to be equal to S of P bar. That is, the amount that people build has to be equal to the amount they want to build given the steady state price. And this is the equation you mentioned, that I bar has to be equal to delta A bar. That is, we have to have steady state, we have to build just enough to offset depreciation. That's how we make things steady. If you have growth, it's easy. Just add G to delta, then you can have steady state growth if you want. But I don't want to do growth, it's just more complicated. It doesn't add too much to the story. Now, of course, now I can build this. I can substitute this into here and put that in here. So one equation I could use, keep my demand curves the same, R and K, and then I can make my steady state supply equal to, what would it be? It would be 1 over delta I of R bar divided by 1 minus 1 minus delta over 1 plus R. So all I do is just substitute in so that I take, for any given rental price, I translate that into a capital price, I figure out how many the suppliers want to supply, that tells me year by year supply, I divide by delta to give me steady state stock, that determines my steady state supply curve. This is R bar, K bar. Okay? So now I got what I wanted, which is a steady state picture. Unfortunately, capital steady state is really uninteresting. That is, the steady state for capital is like the steady state for anything. You just change units and that's back to like strawberries. Strawberries and houses are the same in steady state. You have the elasticity of that supply curve is the elasticity of the I curve. The elasticity of the D curve is, of course, itself. Shifts in supply and demand have, you know, everything we did over here works over here. There's nothing special about durability in the long run. The durability and capital is only interesting in terms of dynamics. So I have to modify my four equations to put them in terms of dynamics. Fortunately, it's not hard to do. My out of steady state, my equations become the following. KT equals D of RT. Right? So stock today has to be equal to how much people want to demand at today's rental price. Two, PT equals RT plus 1, 1 minus delta over 1 plus R, plus RT plus 2, 1 minus delta squared over 1 plus R squared, dot, 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 dot. That's just saying the capital price has to be equal to the present discounted value of the rental prices, which is just take that equation we have there and just recursively substitute. That's all you have to do. Number three, IT equals I of PT. And equation four, KT equals 1 minus delta, KT minus 1 plus IT. And what we really have is we have four equations in each period and four unknowns, but they're linked up all the time. In particular, they link up in a very special way, which makes analyzing these problems relatively straightforward. How are they linked up? Where does the future come into this model? Where is the future? Exactly. This is the future. Where does the past come into this model?
Capital stock.
Past. Right? That's the way I think about it. The past comes in because it determines today's capital stock. The future comes in because it determines today's price. That's how the world works. So let's do a simple example and we'll see how this works. So let's assume we start in our steady state over here. Demand, supply, R bar, K bar. We're in our steady state. So if I look at my timeline, I'm going to build a timeline. We're cruising along at R bar up to date T. We're cruising along at P bar. We're cruising along I bar, and we're cruising along with K bars. So nothing interesting has happened yet. Alright. And let's have Jesse's favorite thing happen. Let's have a one-time fire that comes in and destroys a bunch of capital and pushes us back to K zero. So the capital stock gets pushed down to K zero. Alright. What happens? What happens in the market? What happens to rents? What happens to the rental price now? You have less places to live. What happens to rental prices? Rental prices go up to here. RZ. Right to there. The rental prices go up. What happens to capital prices? Remember, people used to think rents were going to go along like that. Now they realize rents are up. What's going to happen to capital? They're going to go up. Easier. What's going to happen to investment? It's going to go up. Because it responds to price. Just follow the equation. What's going to happen to K? It's going to start to recover. As K recovers, what happens to R? Shift the stock out, R is going to come down. And we're just going to go right back to our steady state, like this, right? Like that. Dash that line. That's how our capital model will respond. Rents will rise, prices will rise, investment will rise, capital will converge back to the steady state. Okay? Which rises more, rents or prices? Anytime somebody asks you which rises more, you should always ask one question. What do you mean by more? Okay? two logical ways of notions of war in absolute terms or in relative terms, percentage or absolute. Because there's so much confusion that happens when people talk about war and one guy's talking about absolute and the other one's talking about percentage. Usually in economics, we care more about percentages. So let's talk about percentages. In percentage terms, which goes up more, R or P?
R,
for sure. Why?
Because of P incorporates future rents,
right? Right, that is, future rents are up less than current rents, and if all the rents went up proportionally, P would go up by the same amount. So P kind of goes up by some average of R and P. All right. So, what determines how fast we get back to the steady state? How long is it going to take us to rebuild? What factors are crucial for determining that? What?
Slope of the demand.
Okay. So let's talk about elasticities.
Supply
elasticities. So when will we get back fast? When? Tell me the factors that make us get back fast. Anything?
Highly elastic supply.
Oh, yes. S big. What else? The less obvious one, actually. There's two other ones. How about epsilon D small? Actually, it turns out it depends on the ratio of those two numbers. Epsilon D small, why? What happens when the elasticity of demand is small?
There's a huge increase in rent.
Prices go up a lot, rents will go up a lot, which pushes prices up a lot, which causes investment to really respond. Okay. There's one other thing which is incredibly important that we haven't listed yet. Probably the most important. Yeah.
Maybe something like the speed of construction. Are you talking about?
No. I don't have any lag. There's no time to build in this world. You just start building right away. If there's time to build, you got to put a little hump in this thing. Well, that's a complication we don't need. Yeah.
Maybe the interest rate.
Interest rate turns out not matter as much as you think. Yeah.
It's the size of the fire.
What?
The size of the fire.
Yeah. Well, no. Actually, in these models, if you talk about rates of convergence, which is how long it takes me to close half the gap, that doesn't necessarily vary very much with the size of the fire. It depends. That would depend on the shape of the supply and demand curves, how they get. Whether they're convex, concave, or something like that. Yeah?
Appreciation rate?
Yeah, delta. I mean, fundamentally, delta is a critical factor. Let me give you an example.
If delta gets very big, you back out of the durable goods.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, what I think about it is this. Let's say I had an asset where delta is 0.2. So this is our five-year asset. We build 20% of the stock every year. And I destroy 10% of the stock. Well, then, in order to make it up, I need to build a year and a half worth of stock, because I got to build the 0.2 plus, I got to build another 0.1. I don't have to build that much to get back to the steady state. What if delta was 0.02? Like houses, we're building 2% of the stock every year. Well, then if we destroy 10%, that's 5 years worth of production. We have to ramp production way up in order to catch up. In fact, what would happen if I didn't respond at all? That there was no I response at all to, that's the non-economic model, right? That's the physics model. That is, I didn't respond. I just, the monkeys are running the construction company. They don't respond. They just keep building what they were building before. How fast would we get back? Delta. So this model, it turns out, always converges faster than delta. How much faster depends on epsilon s and epsilon d. Okay? Those are the key determinants. The more elastic is supply, the less elastic is demand, the faster we get back to the steady state. So the economics of the model, which says, oh, don't build the same amount, build more, kind of speeds us back to the equilibrium from what would happen just naturally if construction didn't respond. Alright? Yeah.
So who in this model needs to understand how the future works?
Somebody. Whoever's setting the price needs to know how the future works. These guys with the hammers, they don't need to understand how the future works.
Right? These really could run those firms. They don't need to know why the prices are what they are today.
Exactly.
Whether they're right or not. Doesn't make any difference to new home developers.
No, so for example, think about the homing.
I mean, a little bit, short version. I mean,
yeah, they have to be able to forecast the price from the time they start building till they need to sell.
Yeah, right.
That's the duration. But they don't have to realize,
than that, Kevin. I mean, they have to maybe make some investments
in equipment. In this model, they don't. In this model, production of housing is contemporaneous. Gary wants to think about a model where the production of housing requires itself capital goods. Okay.
That's like your capacity thing from earlier.
That's like the capacity thing. So now that's a very interesting model to think about. And let me do one more example, then I'm gonna come back to that because I wanna make a couple of really important, I think, empirical points. Any questions before we go on? I wanna do one other case, which is, I want to think about a world where we were at a steady state, and I'll do this quickly because I don't want to take too much time. We're in a steady state, and we're going to have a shift in the demand curve, and we're going to go to a new steady state, K double bar, R double bar. And I want to just think about the path of how we get there. And I'll draw you the pictures, and then we can talk about them. So here's date T. Let's just assume nobody knew this was coming. So we were at R bar, we were at P bar, we were at I bar, and we were at K bar. We're going to go to our new steady state. In the new steady state, everything's higher. So this is R double bar, P double bar. Remember, these go up proportionately now because we're in steady state. I double bar and K double bar. And what's the dynamics look like? Well, actually, the dynamics look exactly as they did before. We're going to start out with less than the steady state stock because we're going to start out with K bar rather than K double bar. So rents are going to be up here. And they're going to follow the path just like they did last time. In fact, it doesn't really matter if we were at a steady state before or we had a fire before. It doesn't really matter. The picture from this date on looks exactly the same relative to the new steady state. So, and what would happen, this is a durable good. And we had a demand increase for the durable that occurred at date T. What would happen for our non-durable? What would happen to it? It would do this, right? This would be R equals P, because, and this is I equals K. It would look like that, right? They would both just jump up and stay there. So what does this model tell us about the properties of durables versus non-durables, say, for example, in volatility? Which is more volatile, durables or non-durables? In this case, in regard to demand shocks. Who's more volatile?
Durable.
More volatile in terms of what?
If you have some shock, it's going to take longer to get back to it.
So whose production is going to vary more over time? this distance is equal to this distance, right? Because remember, the steady state effect is the same. So if they have the same elasticity of demand, they have the same elasticity of supply, steady state is the same, all of them are varying durability. So this distance is the same as that distance. So production is going to be more variable. So durable goods are characterized by highly volatile production, but low volatility in consumption. So what you're going to have, and why does that happen? Well, that goes back to what we said before. Demand goes up. We want 10% more strawberries. Well, the strawberry production has to be 10% higher than it was yesterday. We want 10% more houses. We got to build 5 years worth of production over some period of time. We're going to have to, we can't increase production 10%. It's going to take forever. We're going to have to increase production dramatically. So the more durable the asset, the more variable its production is going to be in response to demand changes. Okay? A lot. Same is true kind of for supply chains. But the consumption of the durable good is less variable. Because it only responds as much as strawberries in the long run. In the short run, it responds less than strawberries. So consumption of durables tends to be smooth. Kind of the prices and particularly investment tends to be very lumpy. Yeah?
And if demand was more inelastic, then it would be a much quicker adjustment in consumption.
And that, yeah, because, I mean, I'm limited blackboard here. But, you know, if I was really drawing this to scale for something like housing, I mean, that distance, the temporary move relative to the permanent move could be a factor of 10.
We've seen that in all recessions, right?
Absolutely.
Automobiles, housing, really move a lot.
So haircuts go down a few percent, and housing starts go down 60%, and automobile purchases go down 20%, you know? So you mean you see that kind of pattern playing out. Let's think about now Gary's favorite asset, which is the things that are used to make housing. How volatile is their demand? So we get a 10% increase in housing demand. And so that's, let's say, 100% increase in housing production. So now we got some durable asset that's used to produce housing. So we increased housing production by 100%. So the demand for the stock of things to produce houses has gone up 100%. But if they're durable, the demand for the flow of those things has gone up 1,000%. Okay? Now think about the durable assets that are used to produce the durable assets that are used to produce houses. Okay? Those things have incredible volatility. So a great, you know, there's a lot of examples of these kind of things. It's like, for example, rail cars. If you look at like production of rail cars over time, it's amazingly volatile. Because when the market turns down and people don't want durable goods, rail traffic falls, and there's less demand for durables, so durable shipments go down 20%. When durable shipments go down 20%, the demand for rail cars goes down 20%. Which means the demand for production of rail cars goes to zero, basically. And so the way guys produce rail cars is not really capital intensive, because the demand for those underlying capital assets that would produce the rail cars would be so volatile that it's difficult to make those kind of investments. So a lot of rail cars actually are built by hand because the demand is so volatile. Okay? They don't want to have a specialized factory that makes these things because it's going to sit idle all the time. Okay?
You see that even in the construction industry. I mean, that's pretty volatile. So you have people work, we mentioned this yesterday, people working in that industry, they'll have other activities they can take care of when demand is down, and they work overtime when demand is up.
And the demand for production equipment that goes to produce production equipment is really, is really volatile. Yeah.
And that can also explain why you don't see that much modular home construction. You know, even though you could build large modular homes, who wants to build a factory to produce modular
homes? Yeah, I mean, you can build parts, but even those things aren't going to be as capital intensive because, you know, they do build a lot of factory built windows and things like that, but they're still not built with the same way that, say, GM would build cars with robots or something like that. They're still basically built by guys with nail guns and, you know, putting them together in a factory rather than on the job site. Because, again, the production is very variable. The production is very variable. Okay, so, you know, it's an interesting issue. I mean, and so that's the basic capital model. And the key way to think about it, now, one of the things... 2 minutes. What would have happened had we seen this coming? That if we, you know, here I assume that we learned about the demand increase the day it happened. What if we had learned about it back here? What would have happened if we had learned about it T minus S? What would have happened?
Prices would have gone up.
Yes, that's the key. Prices would have jumped up. And anytime you see prices jump, that means there's information hit the market. People learn that something was going to happen in the future. So what would happen when prices would go up? What would happen?
Investment
would go up. Capital would start going up. Rents would start doing what? They'd actually start going down. Rents would actually be falling. What would happen to prices over time? Prices are up, but rents are falling. Well, look at this equation. Make this bigger, make that smaller. Well, you better make this bigger. In fact, you better make this even bigger by more than you made this one big. So P is actually going to be rising. Because the time of high demand and high rents is coming. People are going to see that. Rental price is going to be rising. Okay. Now, maybe we'll talk about this tomorrow when we do some applications. One thing you might want to think about is, think about the housing crisis and the housing market dynamics that we've seen over the last couple of years in through the lens of this way of looking at it. And you know, what must people be thinking about the future in order for the prices and rental series that we see to happen? And what are the key drivers? What are the drivers of what we saw? So I think it'd be a good thing to talk about. We'll use this a little bit tomorrow. So why don't we take our break here for about 10 minutes or so and then come back. We'll pick up on this tomorrow because I think we'll talk a little bit about the housing.